I've paid thousands of dollars in courses to learn what you're basically teaching on your podcast for free. What you're putting out there is so valuable. So, you know, I just really want to acknowledge you, and I definitely send everyone to your podcast.
You were virtually one of the first mentors that I looked up to and started following. You're always one step ahead of the game. So I just wanted to give you kudos and props for that, because lots of people are watching, lots of people are learning from it.
Tucker and the whole TTM crew, Dan and Chris, thanks so much for your support. I love what you guys do and a huge, huge fan. Having this support's huge. So I'm grateful for that.
What is up, everybody out there in listener land? It's episode 300. That's right, episode 300 of the Real Dealz podcast. And as always, I am your host, Tucker Merrihew. I've said that now 300 times and a bunch of other times on our local show. So it's been a long road to get to this point. Let me tell you, there's been a lot of podcasts that have come and gone. There's been a lot of people that I've met. But I gotta say, it has been one hell of a road, and one that I'm glad that I decided to go down about 6 years ago when we first launched this show. But here we are, 300 episodes later. You know, we've had countless listeners that have either been, you know, just listeners of the show or have then become DFA members, and I've gotten to know them. And over the course of the past 6 years, they've gone from, you know, just guys out there or gals out there in the world that are interested in real estate investing to major players in their market to major influencers into this space. This has been one hell of a ride. And so I figured, you know what? No better way to cap off this ride, not to say that this is the end of the show, but to cap off the first 300 episodes with an absolutely awesome show this week. And this week's show, I've got an individual that's back on for round two. And he was here, oh, I don't even know what the episode was. It was a while ago. But we talked before about all of the high-dollar multifamily ground-up development that he had going on in the greater Los Angeles area, specifically Hollywood, down in California. And since then, his business has grown a ton. He's continued doing even more. He's got $200 million worth of multifamily going on right now in various stages of construction to completion. And you know, I wanted to bring him back on the show. He actually wanted to come back as well and wanted to deep dive into kind of the inner workings of what a business like that looks like, right? In the last show, we talked all about, you know, kind of the progression, how you get there. Well, now that he's there and he's got a 20-person operation and he's got $200 million worth of developments going on, it's time to kind of pull back the curtain and really see how it all functions, see how it all works, see how they make money, and then also get you know, all of his input on the market today, what he would suggest for those of you guys that want to get into the world of multifamily, what he would caution you you know, from not doing or doing, and just everything in between. We talk about raising money, how to put that money to work, what type of returns are paid, how to find deals, the different types of deals, the different types of things you can build, just everything. So this is, I would say, by far the best interview we have ever done on this show. So I have to applaud my friend Artem for coming back on and really delivering the goods. And I know you guys are going to dig it. So we will jump into that here in just a second. Now, before we do, a couple things I want to mention real quick. Number one is our Driving for Dollars app. For those of you guys that have not already, make sure you go download it. It's free to download. You get a free five property free trial for those of you guys that do download it. And then plans start at as little as $20 a month. And with that, you get a bunch of skip tracing or you get unlimited list building. And they go up from there and you can toggle between plans each month. So if you are doing marketing for Dealz, which you should be, whether you're looking for multifamily dirt or that currently have a single family home on them, or you're looking for fixer properties or teardowns for single family builds, whatever it may be, using this tool is something that you absolutely need. It'll make your life a lot easier. And starting at only $20 a month, it's cheaper than any of our competition by a lot, but it does the same thing. So it's a no-brainer, folks. Go check it out, download it, it's free, and then you can sign up for whatever tier it is that makes the most sense for you. Now, beyond that, for those of you guys that are interested in potentially joining our Deal Finders Academy, you can talk more with myself and, of course, Artem, who is on this week's show. He's part of that mastermind group as well, which we often call the DFA. If you're interested at all, make sure that you go to the show notes page, click on it, or go to thedealfindersacademy.com. You can book a call with Dan, and we'd love to add more of you guys that are out there in listener land to our online mastermind group. We tend to have about one meetup per year. We tried to this past year. Unfortunately, we didn't get it in the summertime. We're going to have it here probably Q1 Q1, Q2 of 2020, or 2020, I should say, coming up on 2020, which is crazy. But it's an online mastermind group. There's no money that you have to spend on travel, and it's only $199 a month. So you get to rub elbows with all of the amazing people that are in that group, including myself and my entire team. No contracts, $199 a month, and we don't stack people on top of each other in certain geographic areas, or basically all geographic areas. So that way you can feel free to share kind of the small, we'll say, competitive advantages that really make, what makes people successful in this business right now is those small competitive advantages. That and taking massive action. So you do those two things and you're pretty much guaranteed to be successful. But if you want to join what has been a 6-year online mastermind group with some amazing people, make sure that you reach out to us or go to thedealfindersacademy.com, book a call with Dan, and we'll see if we can make a fit for you. Now, beyond that, real quickly here before we get into this amazing interview with Artem, let's talk about what's going on with me and TTM over the course of the past week. Number one, we have a new show sponsor. Many of you guys have heard me talk about Ironbridge forever, and they are a great supporter of the show, and I support that business wholeheartedly. They're actually, we've got some loans out with them right now, but we have a new show sponsor. And this show sponsor, many of you guys may have heard a few episodes back, we brought Danny O'Bannon back on the show, and who's also been a longtime DFA member. He has started a new kind of offshoot services business for real estate investors or real estate professionals. And that business is called Call to Scale. And it's basically a cold calling business where a lot of you guys, you know, maybe you're not into doing cold calling yourself. Can't say I blame you. It's not exactly the funnest thing in the world, unless you're David Martinez, which you may have listened to that show a long time ago. He actually enjoys it, but he's the rare breed, right? Most of us don't enjoy it that much. But what Danny has done is he's actually set up a calling floor, and he's got individuals that are calling consistently, not only for his business, but now he's able to do it for others as well. And so I was gonna do kind of a traditional ad read for what they have going on, but I thought it would sound quite a bit more genuine if I actually just told you about them and then my own experience. And so I've been waiting to kind of roll this out and tell you guys about it because he's actually been calling for us as well. This past week was the first week. It went really well. It was a seamless upload of our data to them. They then handed the data off to the callers. The callers started calling. They pushed through all the leads via Podio in real time, and then we're able to call them back. And so actually tomorrow, we have our first appointment with a really hot lead in a great part of just south of Portland. And it's an older gal who wants to sell her house and is willing to trade equity for ease of transaction. So it looks like it's going to work out. So it's that easy. It's very cost effective. And now that we've tried it out and we're doing it, within my own business here, I would strongly encourage you guys to use them as well. So feel free to reach out to them. Like I said, the contact information again is call2scale.com. So call2scale.com. You can go there. And you could also email info@call2scale.com. As well, and that way they can actually probably the best way to do it would just be email them info@call2scale.com for now, and Nathan who runs that division for Danny will probably be the ones that get back to you. But if you do know Danny and you're part of the DFA or whatnot, feel free to just send him a message, and I'm sure he can hook you up with it as well. But I wanted to kind of pull back the curtain and let you guys know, you know, how it's working out for me, and hopefully that spurs you guys to reach out to him and see if cold calling can work for your business as well. It's a great way to layer in the marketing channels. We do a lot of direct mail, a lot of ringless voicemail, some text blasting, and now we're putting some cold calling on top, and it's just working out great so far. So I would encourage you guys to try it out as well. Now, beyond that, marketing through the holidays, right? Well, obviously we're doing it, right? We've got cold calling going on last week, this week we got mail going out. This is the last week before Christmas and then New Year's, which both fall on a Wednesday or Tuesday, Wednesday. Christmas Eve's Tuesday, Christmas is Wednesday, New Year's Eve is Tuesday, New Year's Day is Wednesday. So we're dropping mail up until about today, maybe tomorrow, and then we're going to hold for at least until Christmas, and then we'll probably start dropping again after that. So we're definitely keeping the marketing machine going, just a small pause right around Christmas time, but then we're going to be cranking it up again, just as soon as Christmas is over. So probably the day after Christmas we'll do a big drop, but that's what we got going on there. As far as projects go, we pre-sold another one. Yep, that's another one, folks. The last show, we've got, almost $6 million worth of inventory with a combined 2 days on market now, which is pretty crazy. So Market looks like it's not slowing down anytime soon. We got a lot of other projects in the pipeline as well that will be put into market just as soon as the holidays are over, and I would imagine that those will sell very quickly. And as I mentioned to you, or I might have mentioned to you on last show, we'll be breaking ground on our Lakeview project. We finalized the plans. We've got a new architect who is a fantastic individual. And actually, a little Snapple fun fact for you guys here, we connected with this architect via direct mail. So I was actually direct mailing him about some land that he owns that we were interested in buying. We started talking about that. We found out that he's an architect, seemed like a pretty good guy, seemed like he was very, very competent in, you know, being an architect, you know, not just a seller of land. And we kind of built that relationship. We went from there. It turns out the guy is friggin' amazing at what he can do. And he's designed an absolutely, probably the most amazing house to date that we'll have built that we're going to put on this view lot. So we're going to be breaking ground on that here real soon. And as I mentioned before, we'll be documenting that via another $1 million build series. And then last but not least, for those of you guys that are local, Oregon Home Magazine comes out this week. And our home that we built in Dunthorpe will be on the cover. And there'll also be a 6-page article in there. So if you're at the newsstands and you want to see us, make sure that you grab a copy or at least thumb through it for free while you're standing in line. And you could see they're actually using a dining room shot for the cover. And then they got a 6-page article that shows you know, a number of the other pictures within the home, within the article itself. So a lot of stuff going on. A lot of really cool stuff, and to top it all off, we've got episode 300 here, and just an absolutely awesome interview with my man Artem, and I can't thank him enough for coming on here and doing this. I know you guys are going to dig it, so without further ado, let's jump into this interview, and grab a pen, grab a pad, and you'll probably want to listen to it a couple times. I'll see you guys on the other side. All right, Real Deals Podcast listeners, I want to talk quickly about our show's sponsor, Iron Bridge Lending. If you guys have not reached out to Iron Bridge already to talk to them about funding some of your upcoming flip projects, I highly encourage you to do so. I've known the owner of Iron Bridge for a very long time. I've personally borrowed millions of dollars from them over the years to do a number of different projects, and I can say without a doubt, they are the best hard money lending company I have ever come across, and that is the reason why they are the sole sponsor of this show. I've had a lot of other companies reach out to me and want to sponsor this show, but I just won't do it. I feel like I need to be genuine in who we have sponsoring the show, and it needs to be somebody that I've personally done a ton of business with. So I personally vouch for their ability to be the best, hands down, in the world of hard money lending. You won't find better programs, you won't find better terms, and they're lending or will be lending in over 20 states. So chances are, if you're hearing this in whatever state you're in, it's definitely worth it to check out their website, reach out to them, see if they're lending in your state, and if they are, I would absolutely encourage you to do business with them. Another very cool thing to note is that they have a program for most rehabs where you can actually borrow up to 90% of the purchase price. Now, this is given the fact that you are actually buying a deal, which if you're listening to the show, that means you probably are. But if you have an actual deal on the table, they'll fund up to 90% of your purchase price, and they'll even give you rehab funds on top of that, which means that it only takes 10% down to get into a project, which is unbelievable in the hard money world. So do yourself a favor, reach out to Iron Bridge Lending, have a conversation with them, see if they're a good fit for you and for your next project. I can guarantee you that you'll be happy that you did. All right, everybody out there in listening land, welcome back. I've got a special guest for you this week. I've got an individual that came on the show, a good while back. And I've been twisting his arm, you know, over the internet anyway, saying, hey, you want to come back again and talk a little bit more about all the crazy and amazing stuff that you guys are doing with your business down there in the greater Los Angeles area? And he finally said yes. And so without further ado, welcome back to the show, Mr. Artem.
What's up, Tucker? Glad to be back.
So I've been seeing a lot of pictures on social media of all these crazy projects you've been doing. And we went through some of it, you know, in the last show. But I'm really interested, you know, to hear what's going on now. I know you guys have grown a lot. You got a lot of bigger projects, some different types of projects. But before we get into all of that, I'm going to give you a little room to run here and maybe get some of our listeners that, you know, aren't quite as familiar with you a little more familiar in terms of who you are and what you're about. And then obviously we can dive into all of the great stuff that you're doing right now in the world of commercial development.
Okay. Thanks, buddy. So we'll just quickly run through it. I'll give everyone the synopsis, basically the pitch we give to our investors all the time. So I started off like everyone else, not everyone else, but pretty much a lot of people on your podcast that listen to it, by finding single family houses to flip and wholesale. Then we learned to rehab single family houses. Then we started doing additions on single family houses. Then we started building duplexes ground up. Then we started doing some luxury home, custom homes, and then we transitioned to building apartment buildings in 2012. And I think right now we're on our 27th apartment building, over 200 million of apartments we've done or in the progress of doing. And we've grown from just me and my partner, then me and my partner assistant, to now a team of about 20 people in our company, from property management to superintendents. And we're really just in LA. We're focused on ground up development, multifamily, and just kind of just trying to go up the real estate ladder, as you always talk about, from single family homes now to, you know, our biggest project's a 43 unit ground up that we're doing, mixed use project, and trying to get up to the institutional size 200-300 unit projects that we haven't done yet. And we're also getting into building some co-living ground up, which is basically a fancy way of saying dorms for adults, or projects that are built for roommate living, custom built for roommate living. So we're building 5-bedroom, 5-bath units that we're going to rent out by the bedroom. And I think we see a lot of runway of that in the future. So
yeah, that's an interesting project type, which we can dive into some more for sure. Cause I know there's a lot of people interested not only in the valuation of that, but you know, who it's serving, and kind of just that whole asset class is kind of growing, you know, just watching you guys do it and then having some conversations about it. But, you know, you obviously started in the world of single family, moved your way up, as you mentioned. We're still in the world of single family. We just moved up price point. So instead of doing $1 million homes, now we're doing $3 million homes. I don't know if that's well, from a tax perspective, it's not a smart thing. From a profit perspective, it's working out just fine. But tax wise, I'd rather be in your boat with what you've got going on. But what, I guess, starting off, what would you say was the biggest challenge in transitioning from the world of single family into the world of multifamily ground up development? Was it finding deals? Was it figuring out the world of, you know, what this whole thing is? What was the difficult points in that transition, do you think?
So I think the hardest point for us was to find the capital and lenders that were willing to give us financing for it. I mean, on our first project, as I believe I mentioned on our other podcast, my business partner had to call 40 banks and basically had to put up his family's house as collateral still to put up a second on them for him to give us a loan on our first project. But after you do the first one, the lenders, now they like the product type. They see your experience. So now we have no problem getting construction loans. So that was the hardest part. And also, you know, as you're starting out, they're not only underwriting you as a developer, they're underwriting your contractor. And we were the contractor on it. So we were an inexperienced contractor, inexperienced developer, and multifamily product type. So we got a lot of pushback. But after you complete the first one, then it's just kind of off to the races. We had land for the next two projects already. We purchased and we just let them sunbathe there for a little bit because we didn't have the equity to build them out. And once we finished the first one, we started the other two. And then, you know, now I think we have 15 active projects, over 300 units we're building ground up.
What would you say? Now, you said your team's grown a lot too, which, you know, there's a lot of challenges there, but you said you got about 20 people on the team now. Would you say that that's grown more so in the last couple of years, or at what point did that really balloon to that size?
So I think it kind of ballooned to that size when I realized that we're actually structured as a construction company. So basically our office overhead, we're just basically most of those employees are on the construction side. And we have, I believe, about 3 people under property management. So we have Schoen Tepler Realty, which does our property management. We have Schoen Tepler Construction, which does the construction. And we have Schoen Tepler Group, which is, I guess, the entity that's overhanging. But most of those employees are in the construction arm. So it's just basically people that are project we have a project manager, we have 9 superintendents. I have it kind of written down somewhere here in the presentation I presented. So we have 3 office employees, 1 person for bidding, bookkeeping, and everything else that needs to get done. We have 9 superintendents, 1 outsourced CFO that works for about 30 hours per week. Eventually, we're going to have to bring someone in-house probably soon. 1 project manager, 1 person that's focused on just reaching out, capital raising, reaching out to wealthy people. And we have 3 property management staff. So that's kind of how we've grown. And then it's me and Paul, where the way we split up our roles is he does acquisitions, fundraising, development, property management, financing. And I do acquisitions, fundraising, and construction. So we both look for deals and look for money. And then I focus on building them. He focuses on getting the permits for me to build them. And then he does the property management and does all the loans for them.
What's the permitting process like? I mean, I know we're jumping around here a little bit, but I'm honestly pretty interested. What kind of runway and timeline do you have? You know, let's say you guys find a project, and I want to jump into that a little bit too, but let's say you find a project, however it may be, what kind of timeline do you have from acquisition to being able to put some shovels in the ground and start working? Or do you have some overlap of due diligence and delayed closing to kind of help with that?
So we don't do delayed closings, and we do due diligence as long as if we could get 30 days, that's enough for us. Sometimes we could push it for 21 days, but ideally to get all the consultants, you have to go in and do a survey, a boundary and topographical survey. Then you got to do an environmental report. You got to do a soils test. You got to do a historical study on that property. So we could usually get all those out within about a month. And then we close on the property. And there's really, we're doing three types of projects entitlements. So in Los Angeles, if you're over 50 units base before any type of bonus density, you have to go in front of the planning department. And then people can use environmental laws to sue you, slow down the project. So you really don't know how long that's going to take. I mean, there's big projects here that are just have lawsuits after lawsuits. They could take from 3 to 10 years to get entitled and shovel ready. So we stay away from anything over 50 units. So we do either a buy right projects, which co-living is pretty much a buy right project. The site is zoned for, let's call it 8 units. We build 8 units for a buy right project in LA. You could pull permits. If you submit it, I mean, our architect engineer, everyone designs it in about, let's say the architect takes about 2 months. The engineer takes about a month. So it takes about 3 months to submit it. And then about 3 months back and forth on the buy right project. So then if we're using bonus density, state bonus density, SB 1818, which just basically says that if we give a certain percentage of units to affordable using state bonus laws, we can increase the density up to 35%. Those projects usually take roughly about nine to 10 months. And then what's very recent, what came about was transit-oriented communities, which is an entitlement based on being near metro or either subway or bus stops, how close you are to public transit. And if you're close, it's divided into tiers in Los Angeles from tier 1 to 4, depends how close you are. So for those projects, and depends, each tier has its own type of density that you do. But depends how close you are to the metro, that determines how much density, how much parking reduction you can do. Those projects take usually maybe 15 to 18 months to get them from us buying the land to getting permits ready for them, because those have to go in front of the planning department, and the planning department's completely backed up and they're taking quite a bit. And the problem is, you have to complete that before you could submit it to the housing department. So then the housing department's a little bit backed up to for all the affordable units that we're kind of creating. So they got to approve and create their covenants. So usually that process takes like 15 to 18 months for TOC projects. State bonus density projects, once again, like 9 to 10 months. And by right, you could get it 6 to 7 months.
So just so everybody understands, like buy right is basically you're just taking advantage of the underlying zoning. You're not trying to add any additional units, you know, via different caveats that you can utilize within the zoning code or, you know, opportunities that the state has created.
Exactly. That's just simply buy right. You go, it's, let's say it's zoned for 10 units. You build a 10 unit building and you provide the parking spaces that you need for that. Well, why we usually use state bonus density is we usually need to reduce the parking requirement, because on a 10-unit building, if you build 10 one-bedrooms, you need 1.5 parking spaces for a one-bedroom. If you use bonus density, you could reduce that state bonus density to 1 unit, one parking space per one-bedroom. And some of the TOC projects, you could almost reduce it to nothing, but we still wouldn't build projects that are severely underparked.
Gotcha. Yeah, I know there's a number of projects here in Portland that they actually don't even require parking, but I'm sure a lot of the people that you're renting to, they probably ride birds around, right? For the most part, anyway.
I know. Actually, honestly, everyone that we rent to is just combined income of about $120,000. It's usually couples. They rent our one-bedroom townhomes. That's mostly what we've been doing. But we're thinking the co-living is going to be people that are Ubering or Uber Pool. And if you use Uber Pool, it's really close to, you know, Hollywood, Netflix, or kind of we expect people to be working. So the co-living with no parking or very limited parking, we're targeting for the people that make $30,000 to $60,000 of income, which no one's building for that market. And for are one bedrooms, you got to make at least $70,000. So all those people have cars and they usually even want more parking spaces than we can provide. But the parking spaces are very expensive. Like to build a parking space, rough numbers, like from $30,000 to $40,000 per parking space. Obviously, it gets a little cheaper the bigger the parking lot you have. You get some efficiencies when you're building a concrete deck, but on a small little 12 unit building, 12 parking spaces might cost you $500,000, maybe even a little more. Prices are going up, but once you start doing 26, it could get down to $25,000, $30,000 per parking space.
Now, are those costs so high because you're doing subterranean parking for the most part?
Oh, it gets even more expensive. That's just the concrete box. If you're going subterranean on a single lot, a garage for a 12 unit building could cost me $750,000 to $800,000. So if I do the math on that really quickly, so 12 parking spaces for $800,000, whatever that is. So $800,000.
Call it $80,000 ish or so.
Divided by 12. Yeah. Yeah. Like $66,000 if you're putting them subterranean.
Wow. That's more than the car.
Yeah. It's
pretty crazy, right?
Yeah.
One thing I want to clarify for people. So like here in Portland, we've had you guys get bonus density. We have this thing called inclusionary zoning, which doesn't allow for bonus density. They just make you allocate a certain number of units for quote unquote affordable housing. But it sounds like you guys don't have, they require you to do that. But if you do, you get to put in essentially more units that are not affordable housing, right?
Yes, you get to put in a little bit more units. So let's say you were allowed to build a 10-unit building. Now you can build a 13.5, which rounds up to 14 units. And state bonus density, it's a certain percentage off of the base units. So let's say you had 10 units and you're using 10%. So you got to give one unit to affordable. TOC, Transit Area Communities, goes off of the total unit count. So if you got to give 10% off of a 14 units, 1.4. So you got to round that up to two and you got to provide two affordable units.
Gotcha. I just want to clarify that for everybody. So, all right. So let's back up real quick before we get into the projects themselves and the inner workings of that. These days, I mean, originally, you know, when you were in the single family world and then as you started to segue into the world of multifamily here, you know, you did a lot of the same marketing techniques that we utilize to find our projects. But how is your guys' deal flow derived these days? What kind of, you know, marketing? I know that, you know, both of you guys, you know, put effort into finding deals. But what is your main deal flow? You know, what does that look like?
So I think honestly, once you kind of move up higher up the food chain, there's very few people that can take down and build ground up apartments. And there's a lot of brokers that specialize just knocking on doors, cold calling them, sending them letters. So a lot of our deals have come from either brokers or people that have listings and put them up and they're just selling and we just approach them directly and have them represent us. I have done direct mail. I've turned direct mail off right now because our bottleneck is capital. We need to raise a lot more capital. We've been building roughly about 100 units per year, finding land for it. This year, we're not there. We might be up to, I mean, we're doing joint venture now. So we only bought a site for 28 units this year and we're doing one for 30 and we might do a 96 bed project or 91 beds, a co-living project. But we've honestly turned off our direct mail and we're turning direct mail on heavy for raising capital purposes. We came out basically a branding book and we're just going to be targeting wealthy individuals to come in more as our capital partners because we've passed on opportunities brought to us from other brokers that we just couldn't do this year because we didn't have the capital lined up. So we're focused on 2020, whether it's running Facebook ads, we have people calling. I have a guy calling wealthy individuals. We're going to be doing direct mail, basically sending our brand book to people, and we're looking for capital partners. But if I was to market for direct mail, I would do exactly the same thing as you're doing, hand address letters, postcards. I'd have people, hire a team of people just to cold call the same people. And I have a group of brokers I'm close with, and I'd be like, hey, I'm looking for this. They'll immediately, if I want a property, they'll just call the owner and try to make a meeting.
Gotcha. Yeah. I mean, it kind of seems like as you move up the ladder and the food chain, you know, there's just less people, as you said, that can actually take down a property like this and, you know, put it to its highest and best use, which is, you know, i.e. putting a, you know, a big, you know, apartment building on it. So really at the end of the day, you're competing against a lot less people, which, you know, when you put a fixer house to market, there's a gazillion people that want to fix a house and, you know, flip a house these days. Right. But as you kind of go up that ladder, there's just a lot less people. So you can almost leverage those other professionals because they'll just bring you the deals because there's not as many people for them to bring them to.
Exactly. And if you could couple, obviously, what you guys are doing with deal sourcing, I think that's huge too. So I can't wait to turn on direct mail and have people cold calling and send postcards and everything you guys are doing to target them. It just, we haven't had the need yet. It'd just be wasting money. I literally have letters prepared that I haven't sent out because we're still raising money for our last two 28 unit projects.
Gotcha. Yeah, there's the chicken or the egg, right?
Exactly. That's the problem. And then you approach investors and they go, well, how much can we do? Can we just do a bunch of volume of these deals? And we're like, well, we don't know. We've never actually turned on the whole marketing machine full force because we haven't had the money lined up. So everyone, the money is always asking us, how much deals can we do? And we're always looking for money, but you know, they don't even commit to one. So their idea of doing 10, 20 at a time when they won't commit to one is, you know, it's hard to believe.
Yeah, that sounds like a bit of a friction point that you kind of are a balancing act you have to kind of do. But to kind of dive into that deeper, what does that look like in terms of raising money? How does that fit into the business as a whole? You know, what kind of returns generally do people expect? What does that all look like? Because I know a lot of people, it's just kind of as clear as a mud puddle to most people. So maybe we can unpack that a little bit so people understand how that works.
So once you move into apartments, from what I've seen, is there's the friends and family bucket. It's what they call friends and family money, country club money. And basically the structure with those guys is you can basically get a 50-50 split on the profits. You might have to give them a preferred return, which is basically, let's say someone gives you $1 million and there's 6% preferred return. First, they make 6% on their money for the time that it was out. And then everything above that, you can split 50-50. What we're trying to go for is we're basically going to tell people that they're going to make 50% of the profits or 50% of the profits or 8%, whichever is greater. So it's basically, it's kind of like an eight preferred return to them. Then it's a catch up, 8% catch up, and then a 50-50 split to that. So if a deal does really well, let's say we make 30% returns IRR in the deal, our investors would make 15 and we'd make 15. If a deal does worse, let's say it does 20, we make 10, they make 10. But if a deal does 12, they make 8, we make 4%. So that's kind of how it works. Now, where a traditional preferred return that doesn't have a catch-up provision is basically the catch-up provision on a traditional one acts as a deductible. First, they make, let's say they're 6 or 8, and everything above that gets split, where the catch-up provision makes it almost like a threshold. So if as long as we cross an 8, for them, then it becomes 50-50. So I think that's the best terms you could kind of hope for. Right now, when we started off, we had 50-50, no fees, no developer fees, no GC fees. We kind of didn't have confidence. We were just trying to get money in the door, and we raised a bunch of money. And then we saw that kind of creates problems when you don't have any money coming in. So then we started giving a 6% preferred return, which is basically a deductible of 6. And then we took a 6% GC fee on our projects, but no developer fees. And I think the best now is just, it's a little bit of an optics to people. They're like, how much money do I make? And the way I'd like to pitch it, I'm like, well, you're at least going to make 8 before we make any money. And then after that, if the deal goes well, it's 50-50 above that. So that's kind of what we're going to be shooting for. But the traditional, more institutional type of investors, they can go, it's a whole gamut from 65-35, 70-30, or 80-20. And 70, when I say 70 or 80, that goes towards the capital. And then the developers or promoters or sponsors, whatever people call them, they'll get 20% or 30% of the profits over traditional preferred return, which is usually on institutional deals of 8 or 10, because those guys, they might go raise money at 6% and they got a 2% asset management fee. So they need you to clear an 8. And then they're going to take 20% off the top off their fund. And then you get a percentage. So there's actually a double promote structure in there. So it's institutional deals are a little bit harder and you get worse returns. But the good news is if you do have an institutional relationship, you can go and just go and build. You don't have to look for money, but you're always going to have to exit the deals and sell your properties, which is tough because you are building this great asset in a great location. You want to hold on to it. But when you're getting money from a fund, they have their returns for them to get paid. They got to realize their returns and their IRRs and take a cut from the top. So they're always going to want to exit. So our ideal is high net worth individuals that just want to build and hold apartments for the long term. But right now we're taking a gamut from high from high net worth individuals to more institutional type of splits. But our ideal investor is someone that wants to build and hold. And the reason we want to do this is we built our first building and we completed in 2014. We got 1900 rents for our one bedrooms. Now those same one bedrooms are $2,600 rent. So when we got it appraised, the building was worth 3.6. Now it's worth 6.5. We did nothing other than cash flow it and rent it out. It was pretty much 100% occupied the whole time. And the building went up in value by $3 million just by holding it. And we didn't have to pay taxes on that money. We didn't have to run and reinvest that. So our goal is just to build and keep a huge portfolio of apartments. But that's very hard because you have to constantly be in a fundraising mode. You're almost like a startup at all times. You're just raising money, raising money, raising money. And in between, you're building buildings, doing development, and raising money.
Yeah, it's crazy. I mean, the numbers are big, but it's definitely intensive as well. How do you guys satisfy, like, let's say you hold, right? You find some high net worth people, you build out that building like you talked about, where rents have jumped up to $2,600 a month. How do you continually then satisfy those investors who are invested in it? Do you keep their capital in it? Do you refinance them out at some point to then roll their capital to something else? Or do you keep it in and then give them a percentage of the cash flow each month, kind of keep them happy and kind of keep their returns coming in over time? What does that look like?
So I'll talk about two deals that we just completed. One deal is we were all in at roughly like $4 million and it's worth 6.5 to 7. I forgot what they're appraised for. We were able to pull 100% of the original equity out. So we just hold on to it. We split it 50-50 with the investors. Now, the other deals, what we do is, let's say we can only pull out 50% on the refinance. Let's say there was a 6% preferred return during the development. So that's the risky part. After the development, when you choose to hold on to the property, what you're basically saying is I'm buying this 4-cap building. So I'm holding on to a 4-cap. So you can't hold on to a 4-cap with 6% pref money because you're just going to be losing cash flow from your side. So what we do is one of two things. One, we either make the preferred return drop down to the rate of the first mortgage. So let's say we had a 6% preferred return. We'll make that drop down to, let's call it 4%, which is, let's say, mortgage rate today. And our documents say it'll be to basically the rate of the first mortgage. So to us, if we're only able to get out 55%, 60% loan to value, but we still have maybe another 10% left in there, to us, it just looks the same thing as a 70% loan to value loan. So then all the cash flow above that would get split 50-50. Or what people do is they do what's called a promote crystallization, and people could Google what that is. But basically, when you crystallize a promote, it's, let's say we built a building and we are all in at, let's call it $5 million, and there's still $1 million stuck in the deal, but the building's worth $7 million. So then we created $2 million of equity by developing it, and then there's still $1 million left. So we just left in the deal. So it looks like there's $3 million of equity in the deal. So we just basically run it as if we were selling it at that point, and run it through the whole waterfall and just go through and just adjust the percentages based on kind of what we're all into it for. So really rough way to look at it is, let's say there's $3 million of equity, we created two. So we created $1 million, our investors have $1 million, and our investors still have $1 million of their money in there. So instead of owning 53% of the deal, we'll end up owning a third, our investors will own 2/3. And then the cash flow is just divided according to the percentages.
Gotcha. Okay. Yeah, it gets complicated, right? I mean, for you, it's probably second nature, but for, you know, the layman like myself, there's definitely a lot of lingo and, you know, it's really just numbers at the end of the day, but they're kind of layered in and pretty heavy. So it's hard to probably understand this right away, but you've got years of comprehending it.
Years of looking at it, years of seeing how people do it. And I think if people really kind of want to learn how this is done and how a lot of deals are structured, look at all the real estate crowdfunding websites, the guys that are building 200-300 unit complexes, and just see how a lot of those guys structure their deals. It's the first time really in history that you could actually look in to how private placement memorandums are done and how people are running these deals. After the Jobs Act, that's what allowed for crowdfunding websites. That's what allowed for us to start advertising for our own deals. And now you could actually look in and see how institutional guys are structuring their deals and what their business plans are, and see what kind of fees they're charging, what kind of GC fee, asset management fees, developer fees they're charging, and what splits they're kind of asking for.
For sure. Now, on a structure basis, Do you guys just raise per project, or have you set up a fund that then deploys to different projects? What does that look like? Because I know people are kind of, they go back and forth on how they do that. I know there's a developer in town here that just sets up LLCs for every project, and they raise for that LLC, and they don't have a fund themselves. What does your guys' look like?
So we're set up, every project's a different investor, and people just want to invest in those. If you set up a fund, you're going to have to exit. So the fund basically has a promote. So you got to realize all your returns and then take, you know, 20% of those profits. So we're not looking to sell. So everything's its own separate entity, different investors, different agreements with different investors. Usually if you have one group, and let's say we're doing four or five projects with the group, we'll come to agreements on one contract and we just keep reusing the same thing. So we don't have to pay a lot of legal fees each time, kind of renegotiating everything. But yeah, everything's separate for us. I would like to one day, you know, my goal now is to kind of get up to a point where we do go to pension funds and we do raise a fund for institutional type of deals. And then also we become, the transition I've seen in residential space is guys that go in, they start flipping houses, and then they kind of get into hard money lending. Well, in the commercial world, equivalent to that is you come in, you're a developer, and then you could, if you could raise an abundance of money, now you could become a capital provider for other developers, providing equity. So I do want to eventually raise a fund to provide equity for other developers, but everyone on those is going to have to exit, or if the fund lets you kind of buy them out at a certain return. I've seen some guys that offer to, you know, you could buy out your investors at a 25 IR or 1.75x multiple, whichever is greater. So there's those things, but no, we're basically, to answer your question, we're going one for one, but we would like the fund set up, but it's going to be for different markets where we're just going to be more of merchant builders, not long-term holds. It's kind of like going to Austin or let's say Colorado, and you know, you find land, you build a 300 unit project, you sell it, and you let one of the REITs or long-term guys that just need a 4 or 5% return on their money to hold on to that. Because most of the equity is created during the development initial. And obviously the guys that hold on to it for long-term, but you really need low cost of capital to be able to hold on to deals for long-term.
Yeah, you basically need funds that just have gazillions of dollars and they got to put it somewhere to generate some type of return, right? Versus, you know, generating equity over, you know, a shorter period of time like you guys are trying to do.
Yeah, and also maybe it's just lower. Like our investors look for what's called opportunistic returns. And opportunistic, there's core returns, value add returns, and opportunistic. Opportunistic is considered the most riskiest. That's basically mid-teens. So it used to be low 20s, but it's kind of compressed to maybe mid to high teens. And that's the space that we're playing in. And there's a lot of guys that are just have investors that are would be thrilled to make 8% cash flow from day one. So they could go to markets like Texas or Colorado and buy 5.5-6 caps and leverage 75% of the project costs with 3.5% money. And they could hit 7, 8, 9, 10% cash flow from day one. So there's guys that are doing that. It's kind of, I've heard guys call it, it's basically chasing yield. You're just chasing yield. You're promising your investors 8%. They're getting monthly payments. And if you could do a little bit of value add, rehab bathrooms and increase rents, you could have even more of a pop. And then those guys, same thing, they'll sell it, maybe keep 30% of the upside. And then, but in the meantime, they're collecting acquisition fees, asset management fees, which is basically 1% of gross, let's call it collected rents. And yeah, and I think that business is a lot more scalable. I got a buddy that took his business to 5,000 units and probably the same time we've been in business, over $1 billion of real estate. He's got 500 investors. And I think why that model makes more sense versus ground up development, if anyone wants to kind of get into it, it's if you're buying a building and you're rehabbing, you could reposition a building in 6 months to a year and have it stabilize and show returns to your investors in 6 months to a year or a year and a half. Our projects take three and a half years to kind of finish and show your investors any type of returns. So you're raising money, but you're not really showing anyone anything for 3.5 years. And that's what takes a really long time to scale, because people aren't going to give you more money till you've proved yourself. And guys that are rehabbing projects, they're really proving themselves way faster.
Yeah, that's I guess that's a good way to put it. What market is that individual operating in, or is it multiple markets at that site? It's unit count.
It's multiple markets, it's, okay. But it's mostly markets where like LA cap rates are, let's call it 4 to 4.5. Those markets are like 5.5 to 6 cap rate markets. So it's more, you know, the cap rate reflects how risky let's say, I guess the market deems that investment. So lower the cap rate, the less risky. So LA multifamily is considered some of the least riskiest real estate because it did really well during the recession, but the prices are reflected in the cap rate. Now, if you go invest in Arizona, where, you know, I've heard guys say it's where California capital goes to die, and, you know, you're buying stuff over there during the last recession, that real estate multifamily fell by 50%. So even if you had 75% leverage and your values fell by 50%, you know, your equity kind of gets wiped out. But in the meantime, people have short memories in real estate. So people are just still putting their money in there and hoping what happened last time doesn't happen. A lot of those markets, I hear people calling those trading markets. They're not long-term holds. You go in, beginning of cycle, and you try to time it and get out. But a lot of really sharp guys I know, and, you know, quietly, they put other people's money into those markets and they get their promote, but a lot of their own money they're putting in Beverly Hills at three caps. So that's how I see the world. And I do want to build in those markets because I think you could create a lot of value, but you got to be in the beginning of the cycle. I wouldn't want to be, I'd be a little nervous to put my friends and family money in those markets at the end of the cycle, unless it was a really good value add opportunity.
Yeah, that's interesting because there's a lot of people I see pushing acquisitions and we'll call it Midwest type markets. You know, maybe there's no value add component there. And so what you're saying is that in the last downturn, a lot of those markets, you know, basically the rents went down, I would assume, which is why the valuations went down, right?
So I think what happens is I knew my buddy's uncle was working with a guy, partners, that basically had like 30,000 apartments in Atlanta, and they're all B and C communities. And in those markets, if you look at the unemployment rate during a recession, the unemployment rate for college-educated people in just in California was about 3%. The total unemployment rate was about 12%. So it was about 14% unemployment rate for non-college-educated people. So if you're targeting the working class people, those are the first people that lose their jobs, start defaulting on their loans. And those assets, once the vacancies go up, rents go down, people start filling them up, rents go down, and cap rates go up. And that's how values kind of get decimated. So this guy was worth $100+ million, owned private jet, and he was basically wiped out in B&C properties in Atlanta. Granted, he knew how to make money, and I think he went off and just doing the exact same thing over again with new capital partners. But he lost everything. So what a lot of people look at when they're kind of looking at investments, they're looking at pure number, but they're not looking at the risk that they're taking to get that return. So people always tell us, like, I get better return out of state, but they're not taking into account how much risk they're taking to get that return. And that's what's happening in this environment where a lot of people are going out and taking a lot more risk to get the returns they used to get by doing less riskier things. And I guess that's what happens at the top of the market.
Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, you know, the market that we play in is high-end single family for the most part. I mean, we hedge a little bit with some, you know, meat and potatoes price point renovation stuff. We'll call it value add versus ground up. But we know that market pretty well, so we feel pretty confident in it. But yeah, it's interesting to see that same kind of analogy through the multifamily lens like you just described. But, you know, it also sounds like where you guys are operating is basically a lower, let's call it cap rate, but a much lower risk in terms of, you know, putting capital to work, building something ground up, that the value seems to stick and history kind of shows that.
Yeah. And I mean, we saw it during the last recession. There was basically, we went back and we looked on CoStar and there wasn't many trades that if you didn't have to sell. Let's say you're a multifamily owner and your property's cash flowing and the vacancies didn't really go up that much. The rents went down for like 1 year and then they went up higher than they ever were. 1.5 to 2 years, I think they went down here and then they went higher than they ever were. So there was no trade. So no one knew what properties were worth a little bit. So if you were a property owner and you had an apartment building, it's filled up, your cash flowing, and you thought it was worth $10 million, let's say in 2006. Now it's 2009 and someone's telling you your building's worth $7 million, you're like, well, why am I going to sell now? I'm still cash flowing. So your cash flow is still almost the same, but now your valuation supposedly is lower. So unless you have to refinance or you're forced to sell, people really didn't sell. So there wasn't many transactions. And from what I hear from the guys, it's just the rents went down for about by 10, 15%. on renewals, not the whole building. And then they went higher than they ever were. So we saw that the market performed really well. So we look at it in like the worst recession in 80-year history. The price drop didn't happen by that much. And all the multifamily guys were fine in LA. It was the guys that were building condos that got destroyed because values of for sale product fell by about 50%. So in some markets here. So we feel rather safe building multifamily in LA because we look at it. The first thing that could happen is we lose our 20-30% equity that we're creating. And I heard one smart investor say, he said, I don't mind losing sweat equity. I just never want to lose real equity. So the way we look at the world is the first thing that happens during the downturn is the equity we thought we were going to get to create gets wiped out. So if we can hold on to the building, we'll hold on to the building and ride out the recession. If not, then at least we'll be able to get out and not lose money for our investors.
Gotcha. Yeah. And just to kind of compare and contrast that to the single family world for a lot of our listeners, it's kind of like, you know, if we're building a high end home, we like to have a fairly sizable margin on that. And if, you know, the world, you know, something terrible happens and it affects the real estate market in a very negative way, we can sell out. You know, maybe we don't realize that percentage gain that we thought we'd have, but we can at least get back our construction costs, holding costs, you know, land costs, whatever it is, and basically be whole. But we just did a lot of work for no money. But at the end of the day, we didn't lose money. So same kind of thing.
Which isn't a bad place to be, because you could literally regroup right after that and just go in and start buying at a new basis. But the bad part is, you know, if let's say you build 300 condos, none of them are selling, now you got to go into foreclosure and there is no price and there was no financing like there was during the last recession and those guys got destroyed.
Yeah, there was a lot of condo developers here in Portland that, you know, they built entire buildings that then, you know, it's not just like one, you know, house or one condo, you know, the price gets slashed and you've got to dump that one. You've got another 20, 30, 40 units that now all those prices are slashed too. So you can see how equity really starts to disappear at that point and goes backwards even in a lot of cases.
Exactly. And then the problem is we had guys in LA that literally they just rented out all the condos and they were servicing their debt, but the bank had to mark the loan to market. So now they had to evaluate, hey, what's this building worth based on new values? And because they had to mark the loan to market, the borrowers, even though they were paying for their loan, they were technically in default. So the bank still foreclosed on them.
Yeah, that's an interesting piece. The other thing too here, is that when people condoize stuff, they then are taxed on an individual basis, each unit, which skyrockets the amount of taxes. And then, of course, you've got the HOA as well. So, is you know, the developer then is responsible for continuing to fund the HOA, which is just, again, it's just negative cash flow things that you have to deal with and absorb.
Yeah, yeah. Condo development, you're either making a lot of money or losing a lot of money. And the problem, I think, why there aren't that many condos being built in California is these policies that are well-meaning, but basically there's a 10-year liability on condos. So let's say I build a project and my subs give me a 1-year warranty on everything. I have a 10-year liability. And basically there are lawyers that go in and look at when all the condo associations were formed. And on year 9, they approach the condo association. They're like, hey, do you have any cracks in the walls, any chipped paint, anything wrong with the building? Let's sue the developer and his insurance company. So 110% of condos pretty much in LA get sued. So you might build a condo project. Your investors get all their money out. Now you're on the hook for 10 years and you're going to get sued.
Yeah, that sounds like fun, doesn't it?
Yeah. And then people wonder why we're in a housing crisis, because who wants to build? Like, who wants to take that risk? And you're making regular income. You're making regular income. So when you make it, you get half, you know, taxed half by the government. You're picking up 10 years of liability that your subs are only providing a 1-year warranty, but you as a developer and contractor are on the hook for 10 years. And then now we're in a housing crisis. So it's just all these well-meaning laws that are basically creating the issues.
Yeah, there are a lot of them, especially up here in Portland these days. That's for sure. We have a limitless number that keep coming down the pipe. But I don't want to rabbit hole into that too much. So real quick here, because I know this was a big point or shift that you guys made at a certain point within the business to kind of help cash flow. But what are the different profit centers that you guys have along the way? Because I know you've kind of built those out, you know, because as you're building these big buildings, there's the end return, but you got to eat in the middle, right? You got to pay bills and overhead and be able to support the business in the middle. What are those different profit centers that you guys have built out, and what does that look like?
So me and Paul are actually lucky that we have enough cash flow coming in from the rental properties that we've already built. So we specifically don't need to kind of live in the middle, and we structure ourselves as a construction company. So basically all the overhead is paid through general conditions. So a construction company has general conditions, which is basically the overhead and profit. So the general conditions, just all our expenses get kind of bundled up, all the construction related expenses, office, you know, me and Paul don't take a salary, but everyone else's salary kind of gets bundled in, someone that isn't billed directly to a project like superintendent. And then it gets divided across all the active projects. So any construction company is going to have profit and overhead, and they call it general conditions. So that said, you know, our overhead's paid through that, and we're okay to live. But other profit centers that we've seen, and I think people should look into setting up, is if you own your own construction company, there's a GC fee. It's a fee that you would have to pay a third party to build, and we do it in-house, and we charge basically the same market fee, I think probably less than other people are, and we're building for less. We have good relationships with a lot of subs, so we have a lot of guys that we know that go out to third-party GCs, and it's costing more because their subs are more expensive and they're charging more fees. So we charge a 6% GC fee on the project. So the GC fees can go from, you know, on a house, a guy could charge you 12 or 25 or 30, whatever retail price. If for our smaller projects, we've seen it's maybe 6%. And then the bigger projects, as you get down to like a 300 unit building, some of those guys charge 2-3% on a big project. So then there's a GC fee. There's a developer fee. Usually developer fees, either they're all over the place how people structure them, but it's either 3% of total cost of the project, land, soft costs, and hard costs, or it could be 4% of hard and soft costs, or it's 5% of hard costs. So it all really comes out to about the same thing. So if you want to say it's 3% of total cost, there's the fee. Now, also in this business, there, if you have a loan broker that arranges a financing, like a real estate investment banker, they could charge 1% for arranging the financing. So if we have shown Tepler Realty, and sometimes on some projects, depends who the investor is, how much confidence we had at that point, how much leverage we had, some of our deals basically say that, actually, most of our contracts say that we could pay ourselves and our related companies anything that we would pay a third party to do. So if we were going to go out to a real estate investment bank to arrange construction financing, they would charge us 1%. So we can charge 1% for arranging the financing and refinancing. So there's a profit center. So developer fees, refinance fees, GC fees. Some people charge an acquisition fee on land of 1-2%. Some people charge asset management fees, which is basically a fee, just like a property management fee. It'll be 1% of gross. And some people charge disposition fees. We don't charge that.
Gotcha. And then how does, you know, Sean Tepler Realty factor in? Is that just basically to stabilize the buildings then? And you have a leasing agents that, you know, bring people in. And then I'm assuming that you guys take, you know, at least something off the top for signing the leases. Is that how that works?
So we actually don't charge for signing the leases. A lot of people do. We just didn't. We basically charge a 5% property management fee, which is pretty standard for our smaller buildings. I've seen it as high as 7 and 8 for people. Like, let's say someone manages a duplex or triplex for you. I know a really good management company has a couple thousand units here in Long Beach. They charge 7%. For us, for our buildings, we charge 5. It's honestly not even a profit center. We're still kind of losing money on the property management side because we don't have enough scale yet. So we're not quite there. But on the bigger projects for property management, a 300 unit building, people usually charge 3%, but they charge all the staff of the building that comes off the top, and then 3% after that. So you basically make a 3% property management. Our staff's included in our 5%. So we are looking at it, and what a lot of really smart, I guess, the merchant builders of multifamily realized that during the recession, the guys that were okay were the guys that had management arms. So they had income coming in. So they just transitioned all their guys from, let's say, development and construction just to basically asset management, property management. So they had fees coming in during the downturn. And that's what I look at. I'm like, I want our business to be set up where we have fees coming in during the downturn, so we don't have to let go of any of our staff, and all of them are paid through property management. So we're not quite there yet, but I think once we have all our close to 500 units completed, that'll be enough to keep everyone, you know, the office staff, not the superintendents. The superintendents, they're kind of project based.
Right. Yeah, they're all construction based, right? But so would you say then about 500 units is kind of where it's self-sustaining and it's not, you know, it basically becomes a break even or an actual profit center on the management side?
I think a couple hundred. I think a couple hundred, because if you have like an expensive manager and then you have other kind of employees underneath, you just need a little bit of volume, a couple hundred units to pay for the office overhead and everything else. I've done the math at 500 without me and Paul having a salary or anything. We'll break even with our like essential employees that we wouldn't want to let go.
Gotcha. What do other investors or people that, you know, buy these projects, you know, let's say Midwest or anywhere, and they kind of raise money and they, you know, bring people in, who are they using for management most of the time? Are they just going out and trying to find a property management company locally and then have them absorb a big building? What does that look like?
So my buddy that has 5,000 units, and a lot of people believe that, that the reason they can grow so fast is because they don't manage. They do asset management, which is basically managing the manager of the property. So they'll go in, they'll do secret shopping, they'll oversee the property manager, but usually they'll go in with one of the local firms or one of the national ones like Graystar, Alliance Residential. They're huge national firms. If you look at, you could look up, go to Multifamily Executive, you could see top managers, top 50 real estate managers. And I know Alliance and Graystar are one of the top ones. And then there's other local ones that people use. And I think it really matters. It's not the firm, it's more of the team that they give you on the ground. And I have a buddy here in LA, he's hired some of the major firms and he wasn't happy with them. And he kind of just brought it in-house, because at the end of the day, it's kind of just, it's like another subcontractor. It could be a good subcontractor, but the team that they give you might not be good. So we like to control everything in LA, but if we were to go in different markets, we'd probably, unless we had scale in that market, we probably wouldn't manage our own properties. But then there's other big developers I know that they, not developers, big owners of syndicators, they manage all their own stuff and they buy across the portfolio and they run it more efficiently than the other guys. So that's their, where they can make their returns by better managing the properties. So gotcha. There really is no right or wrong answer. But I think if you're just getting going, getting into property management is just another headache. But we were told by guys that own a couple thousands of units in LA, they're like, property management's a headache, but it's necessary to do, because you might as well go through the pain, because no one's going to give as much of a shit as you will. So we're building them, we're managing them. It's like giving birth to a baby and then giving it away to someone else to raise it. That's kind of how I look at it.
Gotcha. Yeah, it's interesting. Just trying to make it all make sense in my head on how people do this. But generally then they're paying what, about 5% for some type of manager to manage their buildings from afar?
4 or 5%, depending. I mean, there's a few people that'll do it for 4. Like, it all depends on the size of the project, right? So for guys to come in and let's say it's a 90 unit building and you need an on-site person, there are companies that will do it for 4%, but you're paying for that on-site person outside of that 4%.
Gotcha. Okay.
So it's comparing the actual percentage is not accurate, because you want to see what does that include.
Right. Okay. Well, let's shift gears here real quick. I want to talk about the new kind of asset class that you guys have started building, which is the co-living spaces. And I know that that's probably bigger in what, major metros, kind of like LA. And, you know, I'm sure, you know, some of the other major metros, there's developers doing it as well. But maybe unpack the idea of what they are and then how that helps you guys in terms of maybe creating bigger valuations, larger rent rolls, things like that.
So I'll explain what that is. It's basically, it's another, co-living is another way of, fancy way I think of saying, of dorms for adults. You're just, or roommate living. Roommate living has been around since beginning of time. People just live with strangers and roommates. All this is instead of a 2-3 bedroom apartment that you live, that you get 2 or 3 of your friends to live with, it's purpose-built housing for roommates. And you don't have to look for someone. You could literally just rent the room. So they take all the pain points of, you know, kind of living with roommates away. The landlord would pay for, let's call it, all utilities, internet, everything else. So you just come in. And the way we'd run it is, You know, we just have one person per room and you furnish it. They come in one price. Let's call it. We're underwriting 16 or 1650 per bedroom. So a 5-bedroom apartment will pull in around $8,000. And, you know, our market, that's about $5 per foot on what we're building. And it's $5 per foot where apartments are renting at $350, $380 per foot. So if you're renting for $350 to $380 per foot in apartments and co-living you're renting for $5 a foot and construction costs are the same, there's technically a lot more cash flow that's going to come in from the co-living. The issue is there's been no sales of co-living, so no one knows exactly what they're worth and what cap rate they're going to be evaluated at. Some people are thinking they're going to be more like along student housing cap rates, which student housing is used to be, I believe, 50, 100 basis points higher. Now in LA, it's almost, I believe, USC, it's near USC, it's almost the same cap rates as apartments. But if you, some people are saying estimating 25 to 50 basis points. So let's say above where apartments are trading at, but no one really knows because there hasn't been any trades. And that's what makes it hard to raise money because you don't know what value you're going to exit at. So there's lenders that are starting to become comfortable on it. We have a lender that's lended on one of our projects and they lent another co-living project. So a lot of lenders are getting it. I think you're going to have an easy time refinancing it or easier than selling it. But when you're going to be selling it, no one knows. Like the cash flow is going to be the cash flow, but what cap rate you're going to stick to that, no one really knows.
Gotcha. So there really have been no sales of big sales of co-living buildings then that you found. So it's kind of an unknown.
It's really an unknown. And that's why it's kind of one of those areas where if you come in early and you build a lot, and let's say you're thinking it's going to be 5.5 exit cap, and one day you're going to exit a 4.5 or 4.75, you have kind of a huge pop that you could make. Because eventually what's going to happen, the way I see it, is let's say the guys that are building co-living, they can always pay more for land than the guys that are building apartments. It's almost like if you're going head to head for land with a guy that's building apartments versus a guy that's building condos, the guy that's building condos can always pay more. And the guy that's building co-living will always be able to pay more for land. So eventually those returns are going to get compressed where the land is going to get to the point where I think where it's either going to be co-living or how people, let's say that you build a bigger building, you might have a couple of co-living units and some apartments. So how anyone's going to do their math, I don't know. So co-living is coming in. Some people are doing pure co-living buildings. Some people are putting a couple of floors of co-living in an apartment building, and maybe those will get evaluated a little bit differently. But it's definitely an area where we speak to a bunch of appraisers. No one really knows.
Yeah, that was going to be kind of my next question is how aggressively can you go to buy the dirt? I'm assuming at this point you've been buying the dirt at close to the same price as you would if you were building normal apartments.
We wouldn't pay more for dirt. I mean, we look at that. We don't believe in overpaying just because there might be some high valuation, because we like to look at it. If we had to reverse and turn that building from a 5-bedroom back into, let's say, 3-bedroom apartments, we want to be able to get out, and we don't want to overpay for land. But there are guys that will go in and they look at it where like, hey, I could pay maybe 50% more for land for apartments, because land's such a small percentage of the total project cost that it doesn't really even matter.
What do you think, just on a leasing level, have you had enough of those leased up? Do you see higher turnover, the same as, you know, maybe like a studio type apartment? What does that look like?
We haven't operated even one yet. From what we hear in the market, it's a high turnover rate because you have people moving into the city. Now they're living with 5 strangers and then they live in a building. Now you meet a bunch of people. You could easily go and rent a 2-3-bedroom apartment and pay roughly the same with less people. So we hear the turnover is pretty high, but I don't know exactly what it is. I would assume it's above 50%.
Okay. So there'll be a little bit of friction for your management arm. Leasing those up.
A little bit, but think about how much easier it is compared to student housing, because student housing, all the students leave in May and right. You're literally turning all the units at once. At least here, they're staggered and they're leaving at different times. So yeah, I expect there to be more management, but it's not that complicated. You know, when people tell me that co-living is this new complicated thing, when I was at Rutgers, I had a house there that I rented out by the room, and I had about 10 people renting out by the room, and it was pretty simple. I mean, I lived there for a year. There were no issues. So when people go in and be, yeah, but your building's 40 beds, there's going to be more issues. I'm like, 4 times 0 issues is still 0. So I don't really see it being that much more complicated. I know you got to furnish it a little bit and pay bills for the tenants, but if you have one person on a 40-bed building, one person could handle that easy. And usually the rate, the numbers that we've heard is you need one property manager for every like 80 to 100 units. And, you know, if you have one person for every 40 to 80 beds, I think it should be fine.
Yeah. No, that's, you know, I lived in a house for 3 years in college that had five other people and was basically co-living, but it just kind of exactly. Co-living in a drunken stupor.
Exactly. I mean, that's what my, you know, and co-living, you know, when people say that, it goes a spectrum. So talking about drunken stupor, I basically lived in a fraternity house and we had little bunk beds. I forgot what they were called, but they were like, cubbies. They were little cubbies, and people are doing that with co-living. So we're pricing co-living as, let's say, one person per bedroom. And that's not necessarily just what co-living is. Some people in LA are putting 4-6 people per bedroom. I got a buddy here that's doing co-living. He has 40 people living in a 2,800 square foot house, but it's more geared towards artists. It's curated. They have, it's purpose built. They have like a recording studio in there. So it just, co-living just goes a whole spectrum. It's whatever you kind of want it to be.
Gotcha. Well, we've gone quite a ways here. Before we wrap up, I wanted to kind of throw one softball at you here, which is, you know, for those people that have listened, this has been kind of a fire hose of information thus far. But for those that want to segue into the world of multifamily, whether it be value add or ground up, you know, what are your thoughts in terms of where we're at right now in the market? And then also just some things to be mindful of as you kind of begin to make that transition.
I think I don't like look at the market. I'm like, if you find a good deal right now, it's still a good deal. You might, if the market turns, you might have all your equity wiped out if the price is pulled back by 15-20%. But if that's how much equity you were going to create, you're fine. So if they're going to do it, I would say definitely jump into it. When I look at my career, I wish I didn't spend 10 years doing single family houses. I wish I would have just went into duplexes, fourplexes right away, start fixing those and kind of grown that. So I do highly recommend kind of people go into that. And I think you just source them. I think it's going to be hard for anyone that's coming in to get them from brokers, because if a broker wants certainty of close, why would he bring a deal to someone that doesn't own any multifamily when he's got owners that might own thousands of units that they could bring that deal and source it? And know there's going to be certainty of close with one of those buyers. So I would say when you're starting off without a track record, use the same strategies that we're kind of dealing to source the deals. Do one and then go from there. I don't think you need to start off with a duplex, but I also don't think someone should try to start off with a 300 unit building, because everyone talks about 10X and growth. Well, the issue is when we start building custom homes is when you make a mistake, and you haven't done something before, you make it basically, we did on three projects, the same mistake, and our mistake was 3X. So I would say start small, learn, make the smaller mistakes, and then correct and grow bigger from there.
What would, and this is something I've thought about, and maybe one question that we could clear up for anybody else that's thinking it is, you know, you find these locations, right, which we're good at finding locations, talking to people, putting deals together, whether it be to tear down for a single family house or otherwise, but then you've got to create what it is you're going to build. Do you have any advice in terms of the types of architects or who you should employ to kind of create these plans? Maybe some sort of way to kind of fast line it. Maybe you're copying other plans that other people have done, tweaking them a little bit. Any advice in that arena?
Yeah. So what we do is, you know, there's a phrase that we always say, is success leaves clues. So if you're in a market and you want to build a first ground up project, I would go to the city and find out, look at the projects that have been built. I would go and find out who those architects are, who those engineers are, and start off with that team instead of, let's say, bringing a guy that's never built a multifamily, but he's done houses for you. And we did that. And basically the guy, he learned, but he learned on our dime. So my, you know, another guy we used, we basically took from another team. He was okay. So then you just kind of go and just pick off the players that you see that are good. And it's all public information. So you literally can go to the city and pull up the building permit and see a set of plans, at least in LA for any building. You can't get copies of it maybe without the architect's permission, but you could reach out to those architects. And my suggestion working with the architects is there's architects and developers architects. The architects wants to show off in front of his friends and show kind of he's an artist and what he can create, and the developer's architect will build you an efficient project that will generate the most rents without fancy features. So an architect's architect might make a really fancy facade that'll cost you $20-$30 a foot but won't generate any more income, and he won't let you make changes to his design because it's his baby and you're just basically working for him, just building his baby. We have a great architect that we kind of use, and she just designs what we want. We kind of go back and forth, and she knows exactly what we need. Use standard size windows, standard size doors, and just really just we value engineer, so it's just the most cost effective product that we can build. And we've seen the one thing is also for people is don't necessarily rely on the architects because they know how to yield the most density, but they don't know how to squeeze out the most income. So that's something as a developer that you have to learn. It's you're always going backwards and you're basically solving a 3D money puzzle of what you can design and what's going to squeeze out the most money, most rent. And you definitely can't rely on architects for that.
Yeah, we've found the same thing. We've fortunately found a guy now that he's a developer's architect in terms of the world of single family. But yeah, it's the same sort of battle in the single family world. You've got people that are very idealistic and they want to show off, as you said, to what it is they can build. But it's not always, it's virtually never the most cost effective or just a good marriage of, you know, cost effective, but also good design. So it's definitely great to find somebody like that. That's for sure.
We learned that on our custom homes. When we went, we basically, we had an architect and designer, and they're like, hey, we're going to put a glass atrium in the middle of your building. There's going to be a cool tree. It's going to be a modern house. I mean, between a glass atrium and it looked good on paper, but then we went to bid it out. It was all structural steel that we had to do. It was like $120,000 worth of just glass and all these windows. Our house was basically made out of glass. And I don't think we got that money back. I know we didn't. And when after I built that, I started touring other projects and I was like, oh, this is what we did wrong. You know, it's a cool floating steel staircase for $50,000. But I think if I put the stairs in front of the building just made out of wood, I still would have sold the property for the same price. I would have saved $50,000 and I could have spent $40,000-$50,000 on windows, not $120,000. And yeah. I wouldn't have had that much structural steel in there. So these are the things you kind of learn by messing up. Hopefully you don't learn them on your first project that takes you out of the game.
Yeah, hopefully not. Last question. We were actually sitting down with a gal here in Portland who's got a piece of property that we could build up to 10 units on. And her son came up and he was an architect down in the LA area. And we were just kind of, you know, he wanted to give us the sniff test and make sure that we weren't, you know, we were savory enough people that her mom should do business with us. And we started talking about the cost of architects. You know, here we're paying anywhere between $350 and $4 a foot for, let's call it a developer's architect. The architect's architect is going to probably charge you around $4 a foot, but it's going to cost you a lot more to build the product. He said that down there for some of the luxury spec home stuff they're doing, they're charging like $60 a foot. What are you got, you know, what's normal down there in the multifamily world in terms of per foot that you're paying architects?
So I know custom homes, when we did ours, like a 4,000 square foot custom home, I think it was like $10,000 or $15,000 for the architect. Those are like developers architects, the ones that give you just developer set of plans and not too many details. There are guys that charge for custom homes in the hills, some name brand architects that charge a lot. So the big firms here will charge. So some of them want at least a 50 unit building and they want to make $6,000-$7,000 per unit plus. And we started off with just a guy. He was a drafts guy, but he knew how to make these buildings at about, we paid $1,800 per unit when we started off. Now we pay about $3,000 per unit, but it's based on at least, let's call it, it's based on at least like a 12 unit building. So it'll be like 36, 40,000, whatever. So I think $3,000 per unit is fair once you get up to over 10 units. And, but if you do co-living, then the way we adjust it is like whatever price per foot we're paying based on $3,000 per unit. But now we have a 5-bedroom, 5-bath units, which really one unit is equivalent to two. We're kind of just doing on a price per foot of what we used to pay.
Gotcha. Yeah. It sounds like you're able to kind of half the cost really, by using that person versus, you know, pulling somebody from one of those bigger firms.
And it's, our architect, she's great. She did a lot of projects. Her dad's been an architect for, you know, 30 years. She's younger in her 30s, but we're not paying all the overhead of a big firm. So, she's just sitting there pumping out projects by herself. So she doesn't have huge overhead. That's how they can do it. But the big firms will be 5,000 and up per unit.
Yeah, it's kind of like hiring the guy that shows up in his brand new, F-350 that's got the wrap and everything else to cut down your trees. Or you could hire the guy that's got the old Toyota Ranger.
Exactly. And also the guy with the wrap will be advertising in Yellow Pages everywhere.
Yes, exactly. So, well, hey, man, I think we covered a lot of ground today. As far as part two of this conversation goes, I would say we definitely got more into the details, no doubt. And really, it's like drinking from a fire hose here. I'm sure people are going to listen many times. But before we call it, any parting words of advice for those aspiring multifamily developers out there in the world?
Start small and just go up. Like, I don't believe in 10xing. I believe in like 2xing what you've done. So if you start, you do a duplex, do two duplexes next year. If you do a 10 unit, do a 20 units next year. And just always like kind of gradually go up as you build your systems and build the infrastructure. Because if you go too hard, too fast, and you haven't built the infrastructure, you're going to fall.
Yeah, I agree. I would say the same thing with single family houses. Gradually grow price point. Don't jump from 300,000 to 2 million.
Exactly.
It's a recipe for failure, or at least a lot of additional costs and a lot of lessons. That's for sure.
So one more thing. Could I ask? I guess of your people. So we came up with a private placement memorandum. We paid a bunch of money. I'll send that to people. I'll send my underwriting model to people. All I ask is that someone make a $1,000 donation to St. Jude and just send me a receipt of it that they made the donation. And I'll send basically our PPM, which we paid a lot of money for, and my underwriting models, and I'll send my construction spreadsheet. If anyone kind of wants that, it's for charity. It's 100% tax deductible.
Very cool. Yeah, we'll make sure that the link is actually in the show notes, so you can send it to us here after we get done. And we'll put that in the show notes. And if you guys want to take advantage of that, that's a cheap price for what he just offered. But with that being said, Artem, I appreciate your time today. This was a deep dive. I think this was what you probably wanted to do the first time, but I think we nailed it on the second one.
Perfect. Awesome, man. I'm glad we could connect again.
Matthew McConaughey version, real estate version, post Artem interview. What'd you guys think of that, right? Pretty good, right? I would say that was the interview that we've been striving to do for a long time. We were able to kind of really unpack everything that goes into running a business with $200 million worth of multifamily construction, how they set things up, the profit centers, how they raise money, how they pay the money, how they keep it happy, how they roll the money, how they find deals, a little market analysis, different types of market, different risks, just everything you could possibly think of. I know that I was the one interviewing him, but I'm sure I'll go back and listen to this a number of times. Just the amount of information was like drinking from a fire hose there. So hopefully you guys dug it. We've been waiting to do that one for a while. And I'm just glad we were able to get it on the schedule and get it recorded and now get it out to you guys out there in listener land. So that was this week's show. Great way to end up or wrap up 300 episodes. And I'm sure you guys feel the same. But before I leave you, I figure I need to leave you with a closing success quote. And this week's quote, I wanted to do something relating to thinking big, right? Doing big things, because I would say $200 million worth of multifamily construction qualifies as doing big things. That's for sure. So this week's quote is by David Schwartz, and it is, "Believe big. The size of your success is determined by the size of your belief. Think little goals and expect little achievements. Think big goals and win big success. Remember this too. Big ideas and big plans are often easier, or certainly no more difficult, than small ideas and small plans." All right, guys, this is episode 300. Putting a cap on this one. I'll see you on the next one.